Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
The primary influence for me as a physical therapist is that so many of our patients come in having pain or being injured from running.
If you can run farther, run faster, and run with less chance of injuries, then it's probably a good bet that you're going to be enjoying running more than you would have otherwise.
Pose represents the only true, complete, whole system for understanding, analyzing, and coaching.
I was sold on Pose based on their biomechanical description, not of a new way to run, but what must occur for your body to move.
This book can really help someone not only enjoy running, but run more ideally, maybe have better performance, and definitely end up with fewer incidents of injuries.
So along with becoming a more efficient runner, you will not be an injured runner. So this will guide you step by step through the process of running correctly with the right form.
Thank you for coming. My name is Amy Draves, and I'm very happy to welcome Nicholas Romanov to the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series. Nicholas is here to introduce his book, The Running Revolution, in which he explains how the body was designed to run, and he'll teach you how to do it. He is the creator of the Pose method of running, a two-time Olympic coach, and sports scientist with a career spanning over 40 years. He founded the Romanov Academy to certify and educate coaches teaching sports technique, and he travels around the world conducting research, consulting, and speaking to many organizations, including medical professionals and pro teams. His son is also here, Severin Romanov, and he's the CEO of the Pose Method Incorporated, and will give you a brief introduction on their current work and how this book applies to runners. Please join me in giving him a very warm welcome.
Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. We are on a three-week-long book tour, so this is towards the tail end of our book tour. We started off in New York City on September 24th, and we've crisscrossed the country a few times. We went to Los Angeles at first and San Diego, did an event in San Francisco, went to Portland to do something for Powell's Books. We did some nice group runs along the way. We actually did a fun event in New York City for the New York City Bridge Runners. So if any of you are familiar with urban run crews, they're kind of like running clubs of the 70s and 80s, but maybe a little hipper. So we had about 200 people in New York City. We ran all throughout Manhattan, gave away a bunch of cool t-shirts, which we'll also be doing here today. So if you have a question, don't hesitate to ask, and I'll be just giving you a quick little intro just following this video. Oh, actually, it's not here yet. Never mind. It's right after I speak. Apologies. Okay. So what are we here to talk about? So I hope, hopefully most of you are runners. This would be a fun lecture if it's just casually here. You're welcome as well. There's been a new paradigm shift and from the current one. And the current one has been about running shoes and training volume. Ask anybody who is looking to start running, their first question is, what type of shoes do I buy and how much do I start running? That is about it. Nothing else goes into that equation. And so that's what we've been changing over the last several decades here in the United States. We started, obviously, this trend in 2009. That was Chris McDougall, who's a good friend of ours. And if some of you have read this book, the Pose Method is mentioned there, along with Scott Urick, Ted McDonald, who's a local here. Some of you may know Barefoot Ted. They started this interest and curiosity in what natural running means. What they didn't do is give us a practical idea of what that actually looks like. What natural running means, what does it mean to run naturally, a definition of that. So that's what we're here to do. Dr. Romanoff has almost all the groundbreaking studies that if you've ever heard of things like, you know, lean forward in your run, if you've heard that, Dr. Romanoff has the research called The Geometry of Running on that very topic. He's the only one, actually, that ever researched this in terms of how forward momentum gravity works in running. So we'll be introducing that as well. So Dr. Romanoff did this in the 1970s. He developed the Pose Method for track and field. It just so happens that running is our most popular topic. That's because a majority of runners get injured every year, and that's probably because skill is never part of the equation. It's always buy the equipment, do the volume. But, you know, think of that in relation to golf or tennis. If you were to just go ahead and, you know, buy the right set of clubs and go ahead and do 10,000 swings on the range, it's not exactly going to make you, well, not Tiger, but Rory maybe. So in any case, what we're here to do is to give you guys an example, give you an idea of what natural running looks like, and answer any questions you may have. So without further ado, let's take a look at this video. And I'll introduce Dr. Romanoff.
So you're here to learn how to be a better runner, right? Well, before we start, let me ask you a few questions. If I asked you to sketch a runner, would you draw one that looked more like this, this, or this? Most people we ask draw one like this. Why is this the image we have stuck in our head? How about this? If I asked you to write down 5 words that you associate with running, would you have a list that looked more like this one? Or a list that looked more like this one? Chances are, this one. Moving on. Sprinting is a different style from jogging, right? Actually, it's not. In fact, different styles of running have nothing to do with speed or distance. How about an easier one? There are 3 different foot strikes in running. The heel strike, the midfoot strike, and the forefoot strike. What type of runner are you? Actually, the better question should be, could you define them? Let's talk numbers. Did you know that 82% of recreational runners heel strike? How about the fact that 85% of runners get injured annually? Isn't there something we can do? I got it. How about learning how to run? The dictionary defines running as a pace faster than walking, 1 foot in front of the other, moving from point A to point B. Does that tell you how to run? It's pretty ambiguous, isn't it? Wait, I know. We're talking about biomechanics. Well, that definition can be just as confusing. Try and follow along with this. In biomechanics, the demarcation between walking and running occurs when periods of double support during the stance phase of the gait cycle, both feet are simultaneously in contact with the ground, give way to 2 periods of double float at the beginning and the end of the swing phase of gait. Neither foot is touching the ground. Generally, as speed increases further, initial contact changes from being on the hind foot to the forefoot. Did that make it any clearer? If that doesn't teach you how to run, then what does? Well, the answer is running is a skill. Just like pitching in baseball or swinging a club in golf, it must be taught and worked on daily. Enter the Pose Method. It is a systematic approach to teaching running technique. As you go forward, you'll learn how this method applies to running and other sports.
Okay, so hopefully that gave you guys an idea. So in terms of our recent projects besides this book tour, what I wanted to mention was we've been doing work with the U.S. military for 6 years. We started in 2008, and there was an internal study done in the U.S. Army by Dr. Joseph Knappick that showed that our military has over $300 million a year in lost duty time due to running injuries from basic training. So we're not talking about wounds here. We're talking about just running injuries in basic training. And so when they decided to start action, that's why when you guys saw the introductory video, you saw Army physical therapists. We've been working with them for a long time. And what we've been able to do is when we started at Fort Sill, which is in Oklahoma, it's a TRADOC basic training post, we were able to take the injury rate there from one of the mid-level to higher ones in the entire Army to the lowest in the entire Army the following year. That obviously started a whole number of different events, and so now the POSE method is taught by Master Fitness Trainers officially in the U.S. Army. And so additionally, we also work a lot with an organization called CrossFit. And so if any of you use CrossFit, chances are you've come across the POSE method before if you've gotten run training. So that is my introduction. Dr. Romanov will be coming up to give you an introduction to the POSE method.
Don't rush with your applause. I didn't start yet. Maybe you will regret after all. thank you for coming, and thank you for your love. You know, I do appreciate this more than anything else. When I see very serious faces in the audience, I get scared. It's my past in Soviet Union. All bad things done with very serious faces, you know. So try keep smiling, even you don't want to. I got very nice welcome from your two ladies this morning, and Amy, and my mood is quite good. Even I'm quite exhausted and cranky being 3 weeks in a row. I will not transfer these things on you. I'll try smile as much as you are, reflecting our mutual relationship in love to running. And our conversation will go through these things, and we will see how we are understanding each other. Do you really love running? If you do, you will love me as well. I'm hoping. So I'll try to avoid deep, heavy signs because it gets people sleep, you know? So we will start from this point, like, from these runners, and I will explain you just shortly what POSE method is about. General consensus about running was like, and still is, that running, it's so different because we are so different. We are so different in sizes, shapes, and mindsets, and nationalities, and all this nonsense is what people bring into. And so, we cannot teach people, you know, because everyone has own style. Individual are the fingerprints. So compare with anything else what people are learning in life and what under the law of nature has a standard, and like everything in this room, and we are ourselves standards. Running suddenly getting out of this. We are so different. When you come to golfing class, nobody cares that you are different. If you're not hitting this way, your teacher, instructor will kick your very nice rear part, you know? And, but in running, for some reason, it's not acceptable. And this misleading and misunderstanding and completely delusive process was already almost 200 years old. So when I study this and being disappointed with that kind of conclusion, when I was a young teacher, I was starting my university experience with my young students, I found that actually neither method or concept of running or model of running didn't exist. It was a complete shocking condition, you know, and my study starts from this point that I have to find what is really wrong with that. And instead studying differences in running, I just put my efforts and my attention to point what is the common thing or common things are in running. What is commonality? And I found, I'll show you right now these pictures. You will see yourself and then we will make together conclusion. So it's a different times and different distances and different athletes, obviously, but all of them elite, you know. Maybe you will recognize who these guys are. Do you know who is this guy? Oh, double Olympic champion, Peter Snell. Oh, you probably recognize this one, British. Great Olympic and champion and legend, Sebastian Coe. His countryman, Cram, and Italian Coba. You see this long distance 10K, European record holder in 10K at the time. And this one, Olympic champion from 1960 in Rome, 10 kilometers world record holder, Russian Pyotr Bolotnikov. You see, I showed you different distances, different people, different countries, and what we saw there, it was something similar. What it was? Okay. Should I repeat again? This is my question. I'm still speaking English.
It looks like they're leaning forward.
Okay.
It's
microphone.
No, you have the microphone.
Oh, a microphone is here. Okay. I'm coming closer to you to punish you. yeah, it's teaching in Russia like that. Mr. Stalin used to say, there is a man, there is a problem, you know. There is no man, no problem. So, what we saw on pictures I demonstrate to you, did you see something similar?
They have the same form.
Let's call it by very properly name, pose. you see? You're sitting right now, everyone is in different poses, and I'm reading you through your poses, because poses is a natural thing. This is how we interact with each other and with nature. And I show you soon what meaning, very deep meaning of this, because pose for everyone is coming to some kind of strange way, like when you're talking about pose, immediately India, Kama Sutra, you know, but it's not. Pose, it's a language, movement language by which we are interacting with nature. If you see this pose, whom you see here?
Old man.
Thank you, sir. You're not. Yes, it's a man who is looking for a nearby hospital, you know, and maybe graveyard, you know. It's a pose. Everyone recognizes this, right? But if you see like that, so, you know. Better to keep silent, yes. There is young man looking for something else, you know. So it's a poses again, you know, and you recognize this. If I'm telling you, coming to you like that and telling you, I love you, do you trust me? Not obviously, yes, because my pose doesn't reflect any love. And this is what all about. So pose, it's a universal language which people talk to nature. But in animals' world as well, if you see lion standing like this, it's lunchtime, you know, and all safari running away because there is no way this guy will be friendly to them, you know. And that language is right there in your pose. In running pose, exactly the same thing. When we see men like this, you have no hesitation to tell. This is a runner, right? But what happened in history, mass media and lovely runner's world produce absolutely different vision, image of runner. You remember? this happy lady like this or happy man like this, what, legs apart, you know? From physics point of view, these guys are going to damage themselves. And the surface of a place where they run, you know? And you see this, and we see in Seattle, very many people running like that, going to damage themselves, shorting careers, and disappointments in life comes with that together. And obviously injury. 85% injuries, it's the highest rate by any means in any sports. Do you understand? Why simple natural thing should be damaging you? If natural is means that you know how to run, then you shouldn't be damaged, right? How, if you imagine that in flying, birds flying would be 85% injury birds, you wouldn't see birds flying around. If animals world would have this rate of injuries, lion will be hungry and nobody will catch anyone, you know? You understand? So we have to get together into very harsh conclusions that we are kind of idiots, you know? We didn't understand how we're supposed to be, you know, in relationship with nature. Yes, it's difficult when it comes to very intellectual people like you are, you know? There's no doubt, this Microsoft, these intellectual people, very cultural people, but when it comes to running, you are savages. Because you are not taking in account that you have to learn. So you're learning everything. You're learning how to play piano, you're learning how to work on the computer, but with running, what's different? Why are you not going to learn how to run? Is in this case a question, what's wrong with you guys? This is what my mission, to bring for you different paradigm, that running is a skill and you have to learn. And this is what nature gives you, gait. It's a gait called pose in running, and hold three elements which is running comes to only to pose, fall, pull. We have to only define what is pose, what is fall, and what is pull. One single step, cycle, create your beautiful running. Everything else what people are referring to, my individual style or anything else, it's just the deviations from the standard. When you see anyone not in this position or running away from this position, it's all deviations. You easily will film yourself now and you see how big deviations are. And this is what difference between you run happy or you run injured. So, pose. Why pose now? What is behind pose? Why is pose so important? Because I will take in a second volunteer here who is brave to not to be afraid to die, and we will try demonstrate this. Why pose so important? It's called close but no cigar. What's your name, sir?
Piyush.
Do you mind take a risk in your life? Are you married? Then you have to call. You will be participating in very dangerous experiment with a very high risk of getting injured. It's only couple bones only will be, and maybe a little bit internal bleeding. But we will remember him, right? Okay, good. Now, are you a runner?
Yeah.
How fast are you running?
About 10 miles
per
10 minutes per mile.
Okay, don't be shy. I run even slower. So don't worry. Particularly when you get drunk, it's you completely. All right, so we will ask him very simple question, you know, a request, actually. Okay, run. Are you really running? You're imitating, you know. You're standing on one place, you know, damaging this surface, you know. Move forward. No? Okay. Did you see what he did? One more time. Because we have to get this into your conscience, in your perception, because usually perception is sleeping. People perceive anything but not themselves, you know. One more time. Okay. You see what he done? Can we now articulate this? I mean, define. What did you done to run? All right, English. Leaning is not falling, you know. This is what difference here. Falling. I will show you what does it mean, falling now. Do the same thing, you know? All right, don't be afraid. It's just two bones. Okay, let's go. All right, he's... All right, go, go, run, run, run. Did you see what happened? Okay, let's define it, what running is.
Controlled falling.
Control, I don't like this word. It's in family life, it's good, you know? When particularly your account is controlled, you know? But here, it's freedom, you know? Falling is freedom. You have to, but what you're doing there, you are perceiving how to fall. And this is what was unclear for most people, because paradigm of muscular physiological influence on running from muscles, like pushing off, was a major paradigm. Now we see absolutely different approach, you know. What is that? It's a free falling. Running is free falling. No muscular work. If muscles will be the major factor of moving us fast, then biggest guys with biggest muscles will be winners. But what we see, it's opposite. Do you understand this? All right. Gravity makes us absolutely equal in this case, you know. Nobody run faster by falling because of muscles, you know. It's a physics. I will show you in just a second. One more experiment with you. I will show you what does it mean, fast running. Okay, don't be afraid. Okay, just... Don't move. You're resisting for me. I'm not going to kill you. I'm teaching you. Don't resist for me. Don't. I'm doing for you this. Okay. Don't resist. You see? That's why 10-minute miles, you know? All right. Let's run 5-minute mile, you know? Okay, let me put you in. Okay, don't resist. Bend your knees. Okay. Don't. Let me follow you. I hold you. Don't worry. Look, cold war is over. You know. Good. Don't be afraid. You see, this is what already 7-minute mile. You know. And what you see, he is afraid. And this is what people are afraid of, falling, free falling. Because you're losing perception of why people run slow. Not because he is not talented, because his perception of his fast running is all fixed on that slow pace, you know. And he doesn't know where is speed coming from. And speed coming from only from one source. One only source. Ladies and gentlemen, it's very nice to see so many very nice looking faces here, you know? I'm not talking about men. But you have to understand that gravity doesn't care how you look like. Gravity doesn't care where you're from, what your age, how big you are or small you are. Gravity operates with this law of free falling. You remember 9.8 meters per second square, right? And this force we have to transfer into the horizontal movement. This is what pose method is about. The pose is a body position which allows you to use gravity in terms of gravitational torque as the most favorable position to utilize this. So when you are here in this position, what we have GCM here, point of support here. Actually, it's a pivotal point. So around which your body starts rotate. And transformation of this is a horizontal, it's a velocity, horizontal velocity. And it's like this transformation. It's a geometrical relationship between two things. Our body is a rod and lever. So transformation goes like this. Omega, it's an angular velocity. And R, it's a radius of rotation. So this is what radius of rotation, like this. So you're falling in this angle alpha is what defines how fast you're running. So this goes like this. This is what transformation. This is how you are running. So in a simple way, it's a Galileo experience. You remember, this cart is goes, this angle defines how fast this ball is running down. Otherwise, we have to think it's the Holy Spirit, you know, moving us down. It's your choice. So, you see how simple is that? But you have to be in this position exactly to make this happen. If you're not in pose, you are deteriorating and you're running 10 miles, 10 minutes mile. This angle. And pose is exactly is utilizing that gravity force. And after that, you have only left one element to perform. It's action, what you do. You're pulling your foot from the ground because it's left behind. It's lagging. And it's exactly what runners cannot do well, except elite runners. So now whole process, cycle, like in Lao Tzu. Thousand on miles journey start from one single step and continues. This is what you do. You're in a pose, you're falling forward. It's not muscular efforts. You just have to let it go. And after that, you finish falling, and there are lows where this finished falling. Incredible. I cannot give you full picture because it's beautiful, but it requires another hour of my lecture at least, you know. And that, then you're pulling foot from the ground to return in the same position back when you're landing. That's why pose. And nobody can avoid this. Everyone runs through that. Some with big deviations, then it's slow run and injury happen. And small deviations, then they are elite runners or non-elite runners whom we're teaching, they have no injuries. This is what outcome. Anything I can add for you right now? Because you're kind of puzzled and getting...
Big deviations and small deviations, you mean in alpha?
Not. It's like poses here, right? Mm-hmm. But people land like this.
I see.
And then...
Deviations from pose.
Yes, it's correct. Deviation, and then deviation from the pull. Mm. So you are lagging behind all these things. In each deviation, if we will transfer into the just time frame, you know? For example, we're giving only one frame when we're filming on the video with normal camera, 29.7 frame per second. Only one frame touch in pose, one frame should be. But usually when we get people and start teaching them, they have 3 or 4 frames before that. So it's a deviation from the standard. Calculate, just simply, about 41, 44 steps in the marathon runners do, okay? And each step you will be deviating one only frame from the standard. It's a 300th of second multiplying. You understand how much time you will be losing to yourself? You got it? Yes, it's a lot. It will be 20, 30 minutes. This is how, without any physiological changes, you will gain tremendous amount of happiness. Right.
So I'll do a little video follow-up, and then we'll go to Q&A.
Yes.
I have a question here.
Yes, question.
Can you follow this method on treadmill running too?
Yes, you can. Only one thing with is there is no falling on the treadmill. It's like what we did at the beginning, in place, you know? Then you have to, when you go outside, I'm not against, you can maintain pose, but falling will be a problem. Yes, sir.
You were talking about the frames per second on the camera. What does that translate into cadence? I've heard cadence around 180.
Yes, it's a cadence 180. It's a minimal cadence, which related to the using another natural thing. It's called muscular tendon springiness. When you're losing, you are beyond of this, you're losing this springness, and you, because of that, you're losing oxygen consumption as well. You know, because in 60s, Milano University professors Rodolfo Margaria and Giorgio Cavanna found, it's in 1964 actual classical work, that while you're doing this elastic component of your oxygen consumption will be reduced on 20%. You understand? So you will be losing this part because muscles start to work. Because what ratio? Good running or economical running is more using gratuitous forces, which is gravity, and less muscular addition. And this ratio will be always on your way. And your choice, cadence of that level allows you to be on that side. You're going down, you start using more muscles, and obviously you start damaging yourself.
Play some video, and then we'll go to Q&A.
At this point, you're probably wondering, what is the pose method of running, or how can it help me? To help clear things up, let's take a look at some runners. They all look different, don't they? But at the same time, don't they seem to be doing something similar? Now, I'm not talking about putting one foot in front of the other, that's obvious. But it's definitely something within each stride that they all repeat. You see it, but you're having trouble describing it. Let me help you out. Every runner may look different, but they unavoidably do three things in every stride. Let's slow it down so you can see them one by one. Every runner first passes through the running pose, then falls from support, and finally pulls their foot off the ground. Those are the three invariable elements in running: pose, fall, pull. Like I said earlier, the pose method of running is a systematic approach to teaching technique. This technique revolves around efficiently performing pose, fall, and pull in every stride. It's not a stretch to say that you're here because of one of three reasons. You want to prevent injuries, you want to run faster, or you want to run longer. So which is it? If you're here to prevent injuries, then focus your attention on the running pose, or rather, how quickly you pass through it. Most injuries can be traced back to your foot strike. The further ahead of the body your foot is when it hits the ground, the longer it takes to arrive at the running pose. This extended time on support exposes the joints, ligaments, and tendons to an excessive amount of load. So simply put, the quicker you get in and out of the running pose, the fewer injuries you will suffer. When you want to run faster, there is only one thing to think about: falling. Falling is the difference between running in place and running forward. After you've hit the running pose, you begin to fall forward from the supporting leg. This action of falling is like a gas pedal. The farther you fall, the faster you will go. You might think, hey, don't you have to open up your stride length to run faster? The reality is, stride length is merely an effect, not a cause of faster running. Just remember, when you're sprinting, the key is to how far you fall. For the distance runners who just want to run longer, the focal point is pulling. Your cadence must increase, and that's a direct effect of how fast you pull. The average runner has a cadence of 165 steps per minute. When you learn the pose method, that number will increase to 180. This cadence is the threshold to utilize muscle tendon elasticity. After a 12-week adaptation period, mechanical efficiency can increase by up to 50% and oxygen consumption can decrease by up to 20%. So keep in mind, to run longer, you have to pull more frequently.
Yes, please continue. Yes, sir.
Ed, just looking at the superficially, you know, getting into a pose and falling, it seems to take all of the big muscles out of the legs out of the picture and just focus on very tiny rotational muscles. Can you?
Yeah, it's you have. It doesn't mean that we don't need muscles. You know, we still need muscles, but there are very functional relationship between them. For example, front muscles, called extenders, it's quads. They are kind of gravitational muscles, you know? They hold you. But hamstring muscles is what create changing of support. That's why best runners, if you look at through the range of sprint to marathon, they all have very defined muscular shape of hamstring and glutes, because they are working exactly which allows you to fall. Because there are another thing exists in science called extender's paradox. After you passing the mid stance, the pose, these muscles, activity, electrical activity ceased. They don't work. That's why it's called extender's paradox. And what works is here, they're holding you as a chain through support, and plus they are ready to pull your foot from the ground when the ground contact is over. This is what how it works.
Okay.
Yes, sir?
A question. I get persistent ITBM on my left side, and I started with more like pain on my right hip flexor.
Mm-hmm.
And I've noticed, like, so I've switched to running barefoot a lot, or running in, you know, like very, very minimal shoes. I try very hard not to heel strike or come out ahead, and I still get it sometimes, especially if I either run when I haven't run in a while or if I run too long. Is there, what do you recommend for people that, and I'm sure it's something to do with, you know, with not being straight when I run, but I don't really know how to correct it.
Oh, may I joke about this?
Yes. Okay.
So, you remember famous advertising about strongest is the most interesting man, you know, like, I don't run usually, but when I do run, I run in pose method. Keep thirsty, my friend. your injury with ITB, it's a typical thing what people are putting foot in front. It doesn't matter, you will be barefoot or not barefoot. It doesn't matter, you're still landing here and you're locking this, particularly if you have additional load from your substantial mass, you know, so I'm trying to be polite. You know? So what happened there, when you're locking your knee and your foot, your hip goes like this. It's not what nature is designing you. And all your this loading goes to ITB. This is what unfortunate thing, but very simple one, would create ITB pain. We're treating these things, healing for our unlocking people, like making pose and fall, and during 2-3 lessons, ITB gone. My students do not have this problem at all, just none. Learn pose method, my friend. Yes, sir.
You said that, I think you said that in the pull part, only the expert runners are really good at doing it. How do you get better at the pull? Is that a focus? Or
yes, it's a focus. This is what we're teaching. The major thing, what people, they could fall, you know, because it's not a big deal, but to fall, you have to be in pose. But if you're not pulling on time, you will be missing pose and fall as well. That's why lots of exercise devoted to pulling movement, action, pulling under the hip, which is the pose. Yes, sir, your question was?
So I've been reading a lot. How likely is it to get injured on a treadmill versus running outside? Like, there are a lot of people say, like, the more you run on the treadmill, the chances of you injuring your knee is more compared to running outside.
No such a thing, obviously. It's all about I will give you a comparison, you know. If you're driving Ferrari, does it increase your surviving rate or not? Okay, so it's all about not you driving Ferrari or Chevrolet, you know. Sorry for Chevrolet. You know? It's about your skill, of driving skill. You see, and people forget this. They are looking for shoes to solve the problem, or barefoot, you know, and they're thinking, if I will take off my shoes, it's like in swimming, I'll get naked, jump in the water, and I'm Michael Phelps, you know. Are you really? So, why think that barefoot is panacea? You took shoes off and you know how to run. Through what kind of inflamed imagination it goes, you know? We're usually asking, did you smoke something, you know? Probably not. Yes, sir.
Are you saying like heel strike, toe strike doesn't really matter, do what's natural? It's more about as long as your body is in front of your foot and your foot's not in front of your body? Is that
yes, of course. For foot runners, we did research in Cape Town University with Professor Tim Noakes, and all our participants were barefoot. And there are three categories: heel strikers, forefoot strikers, and pose. And forefoot strikers had the same knee loading as heel strikers. But pose runners had 50% less on the knee load. It's officially, it's published in 2004 in American College of Sport Medicine. So you can go on a reference and find these results. It's this natural thing running comes to the point that, like, people think that if you land on a forefoot, it automatically bring you into proper technique. But proper technique is falling first, you know, not where you're landing. This fascination about how to land with the foot, it makes no sense. Did you see any animals are thinking, where is my now foot landing? Should I be like that? And they are calling each other like, how's your foot landing? Did you see any kids thinking how to land? Who is the teacher of these guys? Gravity. So you have to return to nature yourself. If you are really talking about nature, then come back, my friends, to the nature, you know? This is not nature. It's called neocortex, you know? It's your prison. In running, you have to operate with perception. It's not thinking. It's a different stage of mind, you know? And it's very well known from ancient time. I will show you what does it mean, perception. Do you mind do with me an experiment? It's very painful.
Just like marriage.
Yes, it will be one broken one. Close your eyes, it will be less pain. Don't open until I will ask you, all right?
Okay.
Oh, my goodness, it's already hard, it goes up. So listen to my question. How many fingers I put on your arm?
Three.
Open? Did you smoke morning? Yeah. Thank you. You answered on my question, puzzle. Do you understand? It's two. And so what he sends, it means mistake. He sends something but didn't perceive. Imagine it's a naked arm, you understand, right? What will be with your foot down? You will be mistaken over there. Tremendously. We have research of runners done by very serious labs. People are telling, I'm for a foot striker. We film them. No way, close, you know. They have illusion. It's like I'm thinking about myself. I'm Brad Pitt. And then look at myself in the mirror. I'm not. You know, this is what... Reality is that we are so far away with our perceptions that we don't realize even. And this is what in our way to get what we need, you know? You want to have no pain on your plantar fascia? You have to get back to your perception. Question? Oh, Amy, you... yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
If I'm a healthy runner, would I still overstress my muscles if I run every day? Is it recommended that I follow a more relaxed schedule for better muscle health?
A couple beers after I'm maybe. I'm joking. This statement is telling one simple thing. First of all, in the book which you already have, I'm happy to see that you are getting more cultural. You know, it's very nice. It's all about culture. You know, my intention from beginning was develop different culture of running. You know, that damn culture where you're not thinking, you're just going to the forest and never come back. You know, it's not culture. It's a wild thing. You know, so. There are a chapter called Big Monkey, Small Monkey. It's not about monkeys really, but it's really about monkeys, you know? So it's about different energy spontaneous activity we have, you know? I'm a small monkey. I'm very small. It means I could not produce lots of job, of work. I have to rest, you know? And there are big monkeys, like usually it's CEOs, you know? Governing, you know? They are working like 12, 14 hours a day. And thinking about the rest, that this is lazy people, you know. But they are not lazy, they are just small monkeys. And this lady who is writing, she is running much more than her body is capable to take, you know. And that's why she has. And plus, obviously, she doesn't run pose. And her muscles completely all the time beaten up. This is all. Because my students, elite level, you know, who run like 14 to 21 kilometers in training, capable next day go and run again, you know? Because they do these things. Before I start work, I do work right now with national team of Russia. I was finally invited there. So these guys themselves came to me and told, before pose method, 20K, next 2, 3, 4 days, we're dead for running completely. Right now they're telling, we can run next day 20K again in no problem. No beaten up muscles, you know. This is two parameters. Yes, sir?
Will I be able to learn this method from reading a $10 book, or do I have to get a personal trainer to teach me?
It's a good question. It's a coach or teacher, it's always plus, you know, always. Because you cannot see something what these people would bring for you, you know. But this book written is around 10 master classes or sessions, how to do yourself step by step. Very simplified things, you know. You're just going through very clear message every single time, you know. It's possible, but I would recommend to get another step coach would bring you to next level. I'm learning. I would love to have for myself teachers and be students again, you know. Teaching, it's one thing. Learning is a continuous process, you know. We never should leave stage of learning, students level. And teacher, in this case, will be a very good addition to your next progression. Yes.
So when you go to a running store and they tell you, oh, you're neutral or you pronate, it's like, and people are obviously not straight. Does that have any impact on them?
Oh, gosh, there's no people from running stores. I should be, otherwise start very polite, you know. In English, it's called BS, you know. big assumption. You know, I try to be polite in this case, yeah. Never was found anything what related with these things, you know. No one science evidence that it's like that, you know. I just came back from Calgary University Human Performance Lab, big conference where the best boys in this field came together, and they talk about revelation, first one. Shoes nothing to do with running injuries. Wow, great, Benonig, you know, professor. 40 years in this revelation. Impact forces, what we have in running, nothing to do with running injuries. Another revelation, you know. This is what's happening. What about the shoes? Shoes are should be comfortable and protect us from outside hazard, you know. And your body shape is only about how good you are incorporating yourself in the technique, you know. You're good in technique, your body shape will be not in your way in your running. This is what answer, short answer for you.
What about flat feet and running and shoes?
Then you have to ask me about arthritics, you know, right? Nothing. I have, in my experience, flat-footed elite runners, you know. That's it, you know. You only for a foot, then everything what we call pronation, supination, just disappeared, you know. I did this with elite basketball players, you know. They had these problems with these legs like this. We put them on the for a foot in pose, and that's it. This guy from Australia whom I train, he's playing now in the NBA.
They're not using orthotics?
No. Should I say sorry?
How does your pose change, if at all, when you're running down a hill?
Nothing. You're just not falling. That's it. Because hill's slope angle is already falling. So you're basically not falling. The rest is the same. Only because gravity start more hammering you, you have to softening this. You are not allowing your feet going out. You know, you're keeping pose very close to this, knees a little bit bent, and cadence goes up. It's highest cadence on downhill. The rest is the same. Yes, sir? Sorry.
Does some of the better technique actually translate and so on in data, like ground contact time?
It's correct.
Oscillation, mm-hmm. As well?
It's correct. In pose, we have a shortest contact time, almost like close to middle distance in sprint, even they are running a long distance. This would happen because you're staying on the support, you're passing through very quickly, you know. Why you have to stay on the, what is it, vacation? you understand? Did I answer for you?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So some people believe that like races of like marathon and longer distance are actually really bad. They're more unhealthy because they put your body through so much stress. What are your opinions on that for like someone that has a good pose running form?
It's a comparison first, you know. Eating a lot, bad thing for you too. Even people enjoying in America a lot, you know, 50% of America overjoy food possession, you know. It's bad thing, but are we talking that eating food is bad? Then you are anorexic, you know. In running, there is no any negative things about marathon. It's bad things and negative things about getting into marathon, not be prepared to this. Only because I decided to be strong man, strong woman, hard will, and so on. You understand? Take it easy, get your ego a little bit down, you know, get things what you have to learn, you know, and then you're welcome. There's no problem with marathon. It's not, marathon is damaging people. It's people who are not prepared for this is damaging themselves, you know. This is absolutely opposite way. Yes, sir.
What are the three immediate things that people can do today to kind of improve their running? I know that you spoke a lot about your pose method, but what are some tactical things that we can do that you would advise?
What are you referring to, tactical?
Key takeaways, or like, you know, what are the things that we can do today to improve our running?
And usually I don't give tips. I give tips only taxi drivers and waitresses, you know. It's a serious question what you address to me, you know. What takeaway? First takeaway, take it serious, you know, what I am giving you today, you know. I didn't come here to just entertain you, you know. I came here to share with you my more than my half life, you know, and telling you this is another way how you can engage in that thing, what you do love and you want to be good in these things, you know. It's not quick fix, you know, it's not American dream, like I wake up tomorrow and I am billionaire, you know. Guys, it's not happened this way, you have to understand. And there is no miracle overnight, this is a miracle over time. I'm honest with you, you know. Take away, start learning. read the book, buy the book. I'm not a seller, you know. $17 compared with $300 for visit to your doctor who will send you to surgery, which will be another several thousand dollars. It's kind of comparable, right? Here's Houston Zinkemack. Yes, sir.
Somewhat similar, more on the topic of self-diagnosis. So if we were to, you know, read the book and try and do a diagnosis of where we are today to check our progress later after doing some exercises, you know, what are the top few things that you would suggest to look at in your own diagnosis?
It's written there in the book. But first, you will be crying, obviously, after first diagnosis, because you are not in the point completely. First diagnosis, put the camera in one place, put on, run in front, back and forth a couple times. It will be enough to see that you are deviating tremendously, because standards are already described for you, that what to consider standard and what consider to deviations. You will find it immediately yourself, you know. And then now get into the learning process and how to get rid of these deviations. This is what you will be doing. And this is will be process. You know, it's not like tomorrow you are a good runner. Even I had these examples like that tremendously many times, you know. Like where I was involved in the USA national team in 1994. Interesting case. I'm in outside Miami in the deep forest somewhere in the Loxahatchee call, and my wife calling to Miami. Bob Beamon, you remember this guy, Olympic legend in long jump, still lovely man. And she's telling, my husband has something to offer for you guys. You know, he told, okay, give me your telephone. I'll introduce to someone. Next day, director of this race in Miami half marathon race, national team, junior national team director coming to the marathon, and he is former swimmer and he wants to be in good triathlete, and telling Bob, my running is sucks, you know. What am I supposed to do? He told, I have a phone, a Russian coach, go there and check yourself. He is a crazy man. He is immediately driving 1.5 hours from Miami to my place and coming to me and teach me. My English is completely sucks. My wife is PhD in English. She started teaching him through me. I mean, not through her. 2 hours torturing, you know. He said, okay, I got it. He back to the race. Next morning, he is running. Afternoon, he is coming to me and telling me, okay, let's go with me to Gainesville. I need you. I'm like, why? He told, I improved 21 minutes in half marathon, so I need you. And my life in the USA triathlon started. I become a national team coach in 6 years in national team committee, you know? This is what how it's happening overnight. In the cases like this, a lot.
Oh, that's my boss. So to answer your question, and I think the gentleman may be gone, when we work with the Army, there are three things that almost every runner does, you know, with a lot of deviation. Number one is overstriding. Number two is heel striking. And number three is bending at the waist. So maybe lower back pain would stem from all those three. They are all related to each other. And I'm sure many of you have heard, you know, shorten your stride, don't overstride. I'm sure many of you have heard a variant of that. So in terms of key improvements, there are several self-correction exercises that we have in the book. One of them is hands clasped in front or behind, which will be like a barometer to tell you if you have excessive hip rotation or if you're bending at the waist. And so we do have those things to help you self-assess. Obviously, we also have a chapter on video analysis to help you look for those things as well. So hopefully that answers your question. But most people undoubtedly need to raise their cadence. And just as you saw in the video, the average runner has a cadence of about 165 steps per minute. Probably need that to be 180 or above. Between 180 and 195 is a great range for most runners. That's where you're using muscle tendon elasticity. That's where you'll be more efficient.
So that's a good rule of thumb as a quick fix. That's what we do in the U.S. Army. We fix their cadence. And also when we have the soldiers run in formation, that's a natural limiter to how far they can stride, right? So if there is a soldier right in front of you, you're not going to reach out and kick them in the back of the foot. So that's a drill actually that we have in there. I believe it's called Roman infantry drill. You have to do with a partner, obviously. So hopefully that answers your questions. I will take, Amy, how are we on time? Or should we start the process of signing books and maybe answering questions by hand?
We have t-shirts for people who
we didn't really get
questions. We would like to
give them t-shirts. We have like 15, 20 shirts to give out. So we have fun ones like 7 days without running makes 1 week.
And
which one is that one?
This,
the Run Father. Which is another one.
So
we
people who were asking questions, you know, please raise arm. I will be going and give you this.
And we have just a red running. So if anyone's interested in a shirt, come and get one. We have a bunch over here. And
come over.
Thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you guys. It's been a pleasure. Which one do you want? Yeah, the Run Father.